So, moving ahead with my presentation for today, this is basically on a non-accidental trauma. One second, let me just make this. This comes in the way of.
The slides are bright like Cherubilary.
No, I wanted to make this this view. Just a second.
You can escape the
Yeah,
presentation.
and make it into the standard view. Yeah. Okay.
You have to go to play.
Yeah, I know this thing is.
Just
Yes.
minimize it, ma'am. There's a small dash there on the
Yeah, now
top.
it's come. No, I think it's
Yeah, now
okay.
it's come. Now
Okay.
it's come. Very
Yes.
good.
Yeah. So the new name for shaken baby syndrome is now non-accidental trauma, and this is a concept which was also called whiplash shaken infant syndrome, and this is a triad of subdural hematoma, retinal hemorrhage, and cerebral edema, which is caused by intentional shaking, and there is no visible signs of external trauma. Now, the whiplash injuries are caused by tearing of the veins in the subdural space. So, basically, this is a child who is otherwise normal but has suddenly become either comatose or has had a problem. There is no external evidence of head trauma, but there are hemorrhages, there are intracranial hemorrhages, and there are subdural or subarachnoid bleeds or both. So, if you see such a child, always think in terms of a non-accidental trauma or a shaken baby. So this is how it is formed. A violent shaking by the parent or caregiver suddenly breaks the vessels, subdural vessels, and you get an onset of points of bleed which coalesce, and then these track down all around the brain and into the eye also. So a sudden disastrous complication following an act of anger. So this is how it is caused. And what happens? There is neuraxis damage. It causes apnea, hypoxia, cerebral edema. There is raised intracranial pressure. There is raised perfusion pressure. There is ischemia and there is axonal injury. So you see the whole neuraxis is affected and the child can die or the child can become a cripple for life. Now, why these babies are shaken? Due to either frustration or stress, lack of parenting skills, lack of support, if there is fatigue on the parent side, and lack of connection to the infant. So this shows like there are in abroad, if 50% of offenders are natural parents, but some are also the mother's boyfriend. Now the common symptoms is extreme irritability, decreased appetite of feeding, vomiting, no smiling or vocalization, rigidity, seizures, difficulty breathing, comatose, inability to follow movements, and lethargy. And the clinical signs of a shaken baby is subdural hematoma, retinal hemorrhages, cerebral edema, skull fractures, diffuse neuroaxonal injuries, subarachnoid hemorrhage, and a black brain, which is because wasting of the brain due to lack of blood supply to see, and this is generally seen on the CT or MRI. Now, there were 20 eyes that we have had over a period of 16 years and of 20, 10 patients, and male to female ratio was 6 is to 4, and the age varied between 3 months to 6 months. Now, what were the symptoms that we encountered in these patients? Either the head was turned to one side, inability to lift or turn head, and in all these, the parents have said that the child was okay. You know, probably a day before or whatever, or whenever they have come following the injury, they have said that the patient is okay. Pinpointed or dilated unequal size pupils, blood pooling into the eye, bulging or spongy forehead, no smiling or vocalization, poor sucking, rigidity, semi-consciousness, lethargy, decreased muscle tone, difficulty breathing, seizures or spasms. Now, in our cases, we had 16 patients who had retinal hemorrhages, both superficial and deep. Two had subhyaloid hemorrhage, two had hemorrhagic RD, one had a retinal detachment, two had hyphema, four had subconjunctival hemorrhage, one had a black eye along with a retinoschisis behind. So this is how sometimes the patients present where they have to be in the NICU because they are pretty bad and it requires the acute phase monitoring in the NICU. And this is later when the child is better that we look into the eye and do something about it. So these are few of the victims, the anterior segments, and shows a small hyphema. another case where there's subconjunctival hemorrhage and there are hemorrhages in the posterior part. And in the posterior segment, we have retinal hemorrhages, detachments, and a retinoschisis, which you see in this photograph. Another few pictures of the subhyoid hemorrhage. And this is a hemorrhagic retinal detachment where you see the kissing choroidals in the ultrasound that you see on the right. So this is just a small, this of one of the patients where the child had a hemorrhage over the macula, and we are doing a vitrectomy to kind of clear this up. And this is another patient who had a hemorrhage on both the sides over the macula, and this way it is slightly cleaned up, and there is a small bit remaining over here which we left behind because it was on the nasal side. And this is another case of a vitreous hemorrhage where there was no view of the retina except a very hazy view of the optic nerve, where you do the vitrectomy and clear out as much as possible. Now, this is a few of the patients who were this. You can see the frightened look. They have all these kind of bizarre looks. And this is a child who is inattentive. There is no attention span. This is another patient where most of the blood has cleared, but a small bit still remained in the posterior pole in and around the fovea. And that is the ultrasound plate. And the treatment which was done was injection of long acting gas and anti-VEGFs were done in two patients. Injection of TPA and gas was done in two patients. Drainage of subchoroidal hemorrhage with pars plana vitrectomy and silicon oil injection in two. RD surgery with vitrectomy in three. Submacular drainage not done in any. We cleared it from this from above the macula, and glasses were given to 9 patients out of 10. So it is often fatal, and the thing is that it causes severe brain damage resulting in lifelong disability. The estimated death rates are between 15 to 38%. So the thing is that when you they range from, the prognosis depends on the severity, and it ranges from total recovery to severe disability. So 1/3 die, 1/3 land up with a severe major neurological condition, and 1/3 survive in good condition. And they have neurological impairments where they have learning disabilities, seizure disorders, speech disabilities, hydrocephalus, cerebral palsy, and visual disorders. These are things which are done to kind of find out at the beginning. And how can it be prevented? That you have to like sort of tell the patients, the parents, that you know, when a baby cries, put the baby down, watch somebody, try gently rocking the baby or giving a pacifier or shush it or swaddle it. Or if you're so angry, you just leave the house, exit the house, and then come back after 5 minutes, because the thing is that your initial anger goes down. So this is a condition which requires a multidisciplinary approach where you involve all branches of medicine, which is whether it's emergency medicine, intensive care, critical care, neurosurgery, neurology, ophthalmology, orthopedics, radiology, pathology, pediatrics, and family medicine, and also allied health professions, because the rehab is also very important in these patients. And you require other services like police services, legal services, and all that. So like, I think a whole gamut is involved in the rehab. Now, mental, the focus is to improve the health and the mental health of the patient, speech and language, infant stimulation, rehabilitation. And this is done because there are several kinds of this. You get ADDs, ADHDs, global delays, dyslexia, learning disabilities, cerebral palsy as long-term consequences of these children. And they can have memory loss and developmental delays and hearing impairments, paralysis, and seizures as this. So the rehabilitation was done in 9 patients, where this was the list, that is cerebral palsy was 4 patients, autism 1, ADD 1. And I'll just go into, they do a sensory integration and a neurodevelopmental therapy. This is a child who's a CP who's undergoing neurodevelopmental therapy. Now he's learned to walk. This is one classic child who was better before, but then after he recovered, he used to babble like this. And this child was having bizarre movements and this like this. But Following rehabilitation and the institution of glasses, the child improved steadily, where he was able to localize things, but after some time. And later, now the child is about 5 years old, and the child is now capable of independent ambulation. And these are the patients who have undergone physiotherapy. So the legal issues are there. Actually, if there is, this is a condition where you have to inform the police, because it's very important. And what is the problem if you can't...
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you.
Finished. Better that the baby cries than the baby dies. So never, never shake your baby. Thank you so much for your kind attention. Thank you all for your patient listening.